y'all, Sarah Luhu here, and today we are going to be playing a game called Syberia. Now this is going to be a little different than normal because I've actually played Syberia before. Like, I'll be upfront about that right now. But the reason I wanted to revisit it is because Syberia 3 just came out last week, and like, I've been waiting for that game for a good 4 years since it was announced back in, like, 2013. I'm pretty certain it was 2013 when they announced it, but I have been waiting so long for that game. And I really wanted to play it on the channel, but the more I thought about it, the more I was like, it would be kind of weird just to jump into the third one because, you know, some people might not know the game and I want to play it on the channel. I want everybody to enjoy it and everything, and I thought about, like, doing a giveaway or something, but then if I did a giveaway, then only one person would get to play it, and I kind of wanted to replay this before I played Syberia 3 anyway, so yeah, this is what we're going to be doing today. That's the plan anyway. We're going to be playing this, and I'm going to try to have a video for this up every single day so we can breeze right on through Syberia 1 and 2 and get straight on into Syberia 3. Just going to be playing them all back to back to back, so let's just start a new game, shall we? Golly, it's been a couple years since I played this last, I think. Syberia! Valadeline, French Alps. Alright, here we go. So, I'm going to actually try to remain a bit more quiet than usual during, like, the cutscenes and everything, because I really, really adore these cutscenes, and they're few and far between, and I'm really surprised. That actually held up pretty well. I mean, you know, it's not the greatest of graphics, but it was still very beautiful from what I can see. And, I don't know, I have to say, it's a little sad, no matter what, that the only people in that procession were not actual people. Alright, so, let us introduce ourselves. This is our wonderful protagonist, Kate Walker, and she has a suitcase.
I really don't have the strength to take this suitcase any further. I wonder who can help me.
I don't remember you being quite this whiny, Kate. Let's see. What else we got here? We had something over there. Just going to pocket this all nonchalantly. Holy, welcome to Valadeline, the world capital of mechanical toys. Let yourself be transported by the magnificent landscape surrounding Valadeline and a small charming town tucked away in the Alps by Vorarlberg Manufacturing, whose exceptional I don't know French. I took French, but I don't remember it. Savoir-faire in the specialized world of luxury mechanical toys and automatons is at the root of Valadeline's reputation around the world. For 800 years, the Vorarlberg family has passed its knowledge from generation to generation, perfecting the art of that particular branch of clockmaking that breathes life into the complex network of cogs and spindles that make up automatons. Its creative wonders, once defied, will even drew admiration of young and old alike. People would come from across Europe for a chance to vie for the right to own one of these fantastic toys. At the heart of a mechanical automaton is a motor. A series of spindles are set in motion to music via a set of cogs. Attached to the spindles are cams that are shaped in the image of the music. In turn, they command a series of rods which control the gestures of toys at their tips. We came for an extraordinary plot, but we stayed for all the toy manufacturing information. Automaton construction takes place in three stages: modeling, mechanics, and casing. The process requires the participation of 20 different specialized trades. In its heyday, the Wurlberg factory employed over 100 craftsmen, mechanics, watchmakers, sculptors, tailors, and dressmakers, working in separate workshops. Don't see that kind of commitment these days. Wurlberg automatons all have two distinguishing features in common: their high-precision mechanisms and their characteristic Wurlberg wind-up key. Devising and assembling each model is a meticulous process. Standard toys are constructed from local wood, while the most sophisticated ones use more precious resources, such as ebony imported from Madagascar. Despite competition from Asia, the Wurlbergs never gave in to the temptation to produce electrical robots and chose to continue their exploration of the mysterious and perpetual mechanical motion. Always remember, automatons and robots are not the same thing. They are two completely different entities. Wurlbergs have come a long way from their simple jointed puppets of yesteryear. Today, their creations are so lifelike, one has the impression that they can think for themselves. The first signs of puppet manufacture in Valladolid go back to the 13th century. While there was maybe no definite puppet industry at the time, Hermann Wurlberg's renown was recognized even in the court of the emperor. Dun dun dun. Oh look, I thought that was a baby. It's actually an automaton. Fear it. From the archives of the Art and History Museum of Lausanne, Switzerland. The artisan H. Wurlberg and a servant presenting his puppets to the emperor. I wonder if they just edited. Like an old painting or something. It would be a tapestry. Okay, final pages. It was not until the 17th century that Charles Wurlberg founded the Wurlberg Mechanical Toy and Puppet Factory. And industrial activity in the valley really took off. The reputation of Valladolid and its famous toys then just kept growing and growing. Charles Wurlberg, with one of his creations, a large part of production was devoted to producing theatrical puppets all at the time. It almost looks like a real child, a creepy-ass child with weird stringy hair, but a real child! The turn of the 20th century was Valladolid's golden age, as expressed in the factory's impressive architecture and the main houses of the town. The Wurlberg reputation crossed the oceans, dispatching its fine precision mechanisms across the globe to delight buyers. Why can I not speak? Who began to believe that Wurlberg automatons had a life of their own? Rudolf Wurlberg managed the business during the glory years of the Wurlberg factory. Praise him! Okay, since the end of the Second World War, the destiny of the factory has been in the hands of Rudolf's daughter, Anna Wurlberg, the last and sole descendant of the prestigious line of craftsmen. The inspiring figure negotiated the business through the end of the war. She breathed new life into production by creating works of art to appeal to experts and enthusiasts alike. Wurlberg automatons became rare collector's items, with highly innovative mechanisms of unequaled ingeniousness even to this day. Anybody remember the name that was on the side of the procession? Yeah, that's a thing. Is that a window I can look out, or is that me clicking on the door? That might just be me clicking on the door.
I'll wait for the storm to end before I step outside.
Yeah, smart. Don't want to get your hair wet. This is just kind of drawn on there, isn't it? Huh. It almost looks like it's 3D, but really it's just something that they drew. She's the only 3D thing here. Okay. Oh, yeah. Let's inspect this desk. Front desk. Oh, how cute! Quickie? Oh, you don't. Oh, I see. I forgot about this. Let's see.
I need a key.
Yeah, we got a key. The question is, how do we do this again? There we go. Yes, I need this. And I need this to go in you. Nice and wound up, and let's go ahead and play! So cute. I kinda wish I had something like this.
Okay, I'm coming.
Oh, hey, there's a person in the corner. And there's you! Golly, you have a magnificent mustache, good sir!
Hello there, ma'am.
Hi, I am Kate Walker.
I would like a room. My company should have made a reservation in the name of Walker. The company is Marson and Lormont Associates. The name is Kate Walker.
Of course, Miss Walker. You are in room 6 on the next floor.
That's right. She's a lawyer, isn't she? And I guess
Could
I need help with something.
Could you possibly take my luggage up, please?
Please do excuse me, Miss Walker. We have been neglecting our duties. Guests are so rare these days that we forget our manners. So you're the American woman? Is it true what people say? That you've come to buy the factory?
Not factory. Anna's house. Han's house.
Excuse me?
Would you quiet down, you mischievous little boy?
Oh no, he's just a kid.
I imagine our little town must disappoint you. You see, today is very sad for us. It's a day of mourning. Today is the funeral of Miss Anna.
Yeah, I noticed.
Oh, sad, but Han's not dead. Han's long way away. Anna told Momo. Anna liked Momo very much.
That's enough, Momo. Stop pestering the lady. Now go on, scram. Get out of here, you hear?
Come on, dude. He's just a little boy. Bye, Momo. Such expert running animation.
Say? Oh,
just
yes.
Just like
Miss
a
Anna.
Little T-Rex.
Such a great loss for Valedilan, it really is.
Valedilan, there we go.
Now that she's dead, the factory will close. But you're here to stop that happening, aren't you? Our future is in your hands, Miss Walker.
What? Anna Varlberg is dead?
You saw a procession of automatons with the name Anna written on the side of it, Kate. Come on now, girl.
Here's your room. I hope you like it, Miss Walker.
Oh, I'm sure I will. It will be more than sufficient. It's a very nice little hotel thing.
I'll leave you to rest for the time being. You must have a lot of work to do. You know, the takeover of the factory is very good news for us here. It would make us very happy to see life return to our valley.
Doesn't seem like it'll make Momo happy.
I've seen Valedilen before. It was delightful. People came from all over the world to buy Vorarlberg automatons.
Yeah, we read about that little pamphlet thing we stole.
Somebody has left you some mail, I see. Remember, if you need anything at all, we're not far away, Miss Walker.
Very much appreciated. Technically, it's not stealing the pamphlet. I mean, it's probably a touristy thing that you're just allowed to pick up. But still, I like how she just kind of awkwardly pocketed it in her jacket. All right, well, let's see if we have anything of use in our suitcase.
I don't need that for the time being.
All right, be that way. Is that a light? It's weird. It looks like a little... It kind of looks like a lighter. It kind of looks like... Oh, no. A little satellite dish? Strange. Very strange. Come on, let's go read our thing. Hello. Yes, it is a light. Just has a very weird bulb in one of them. Awkward pocketing. yay, it's a fax. Don't get those much anymore. From Edward Marson. Dear Kate, our client, the Universal Toy Company, is more than eager to see conclusions from the talks with Vorarlberg Manufacturing with view to take over in the days to come, and we have received notification to this effect. We're counting on your undoubted qualities as a business lawyer to bring negotiations with Madame Vorarlberg, the current owner, to a close. For some reason, I was under the impression she was a journalist before starting this up. I did not remember that she was a lawyer. Allow me to remind you that the Universal Toy Company is a multinational which has a monopoly on the toy market. Is that legal? It is a Class A priority client who is also presenting Madame Vorarlberg with a golden opportunity to sell her factory. You should remind her of this fact in case she starts having last-minute second thoughts before signing the purchase agreement. I am under no doubt that you will live up to the great expectations I have for you. Edward Marson. Well, what do I do if she's dead, Eddie? Because, I mean, does that mean she...
I should tell Marson about the death of Miss Vorarlberg. I hope this isn't going to get too complicated. I can't see myself staying here too long.
Oh, darling. You are in for it. All right, let's go find us an Eddie Marson to discuss things with. Oh look, we have our company, I mean not our company, our Whirlbird guy. The one who saw it in its golden age. You know, I'm still kind of confused about what time period this was supposed to be set in. I think it's supposed to be ambiguous, but, you know, it's questionable. I wonder when this even came out. Was this the 90s or the 2000s? It might be the 2000s that this originally came out. Yeah, I think it was like either 2000 or 2002 that Syberia originally came out. Hey, do you have a phone, dude?
I'm back again.
Miss Walker?
Hans, yeah, what's that about?
The boy who was here earlier talked about, Hans. Who is Hans?
Momo was talking about Hans Vorarlberg, Anna's younger brother. But he died a long time ago. Nobody here even met him.
Okay. And what's Momo's dealio?
The boy who was drawing here earlier, is he your son?
Heaven forbid, no, not at all. He's not a bad boy, no. Momo is just a little simple, that's all.
What is his connection with Anna Vorarlberg?
Momo is what you'd call the village idiot. And
well, Anna, you are much more of an asshole than I remember.
He must have reminded her of her younger brother, no doubt. And birds of a feather stick together, don't they?
You're implying that Anna Vorarlberg was a little bit slow as well?
Heaven forbid. No, not at all. She was a real loner. She kept to herself, that's all.
Okay. Automatons.
I just love all these little mechanical robots.
They're so cute,
I've
right?
I noticed there are tons of them here in Valadilen.
I can't wait to see
careful
more.
Careful what you say. Vorarlberg automatons are not robots. If you want people to like you here, never ever pronounce the word robot.
Told you.
Okay. What is the difference between an automaton and a robot, then?
Well, to tell you the truth, no one really knows.
Robots operate on their own computer system. Automatons are mechanical things that use wind up in motion, right? And
did
Emma,
you know
Anna.
Anna Vorarlberg yourself?
Oh, why, of course I did. I mean, well, not really. She was a very great lady. We loved her very much. May she rest in peace.
Yeah, but nothing personal, because the whole loner
like
thing.
I would like to see my room now.
Certainly, of course.
Kate? Did you just... You were just there, girl. Okay. There they are. These just went flying when little Momo ran for it, didn't he? Slowly, ever so slowly. Some little gears for us. Come on. Pick it up. Taking her sweet time. Now let's see. What were we supposed to do with these? Aha! Okay, I think we might have a puzzle here. Okay, large cock. Oh, no, wait. This isn't a thing. This is a memory thing. This is a memory thing. Okay. Going to take a little picture just because I'm a cheating new person. Blah, 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 blah. Oh, hey, I didn't notice that. What do we got there? Oh, wait, that's just my that's just my mouse. I'm like, hey, what is that thing? Is that a ring? I don't remember anything about rings. And, yep, nope, that is just our cursor. I am just not the smartest of books. Okay, what else do we have? Nothing. Oh, is that? No, that's nothing. That just is, that's probably us leaving into the next area. Yep. Alright, and you sure you can't leave out of here yet?
I'll wait for the storm to
okay,
end before
okay,
I step
I understand.
Outside.
I get it, girl. I get it. Fine. Let's see what else we can discover. I guess we have to go back to our room. Maybe sleep it off. I don't remember too much about the puzzles here. What we got here? Another room. This isn't our room.
No need to go down there.
Are you certain? I think we should. I think we should explore this, don't you? Oh wait, no, we're already going to our room. can't go any further than our room, so let's see what we can do with what we got here. Can I Go through the thing? Okay, go through
no
the door?
No need to go down there.
Really? You certain? Hmm. Oh, great. Already a few minutes in and I forgot what I'm supposed to do. Oh, here we go. Maybe suitcase?
I don't need that for the time being.
Okay, fine, fine. All right, give me a minute. I'm gonna explore and all that wonderful stuff. Okay. Think this is what I was supposed to do. Right? Yes? Did I do good?
How can I help you?
Yay!
Can you put me through Mr. Marson, please? It's Kate Walker.
Hold the line, please.
Oh, yes. Classic waiting music. The things that all exciting adventures are made
Hello,
of.
Hello, Kate. So tell me, how's the case going?
I've just got to Valadilin, and there's a slight problem, Mr. Marson, I'm afraid. Mrs. Vorlberg is dead.
Dun dun dun!
Most unfortunate. But I seem to remember we made provisions for just such a sad eventuality, and we know that there was no heir.
Yes, that's right, but...
So where's the problem, Kate? Contact the notary right away. I'll get my secretary to fax you his address and an introduction letter from the firm.
Very good, Mr. Marson.
Right, I gotta go, Kate. Keep me up to date, okay?
I just...
Yeah, I'll... Remember the cell phone. Yay, we got something new. Alright. I completely forgot about the cell phone mechanic. So this had to be early 2000s with this game if we have a phone. No, wrong thing. Personal file, that's what I'm after. Did I get an update? No? Okay, I didn't get anything new there. Oh, I must have gotten something new for my dialogue notebook. Oh, I got a mission. Okay, that's new. Alright, I'm on a mission now! Now things can truly begin. Yay, running! Come on, I told you to run, not walk. But she will do as she does. Alright, kitty girl. Let's talk to Mustache about our mission then. See if this will improve our info.
Maybe. I thought I heard the phone ring.
Do you think you might want to go and check?
Just maybe?
Not. Immediately.
Thank you very much.
I shouldn't have to tell you to do these things, man. It's your job. Your job isn't to stand here looking at nothing. It's to do things. Seriously, why wouldn't you go do something? It's just like, all he's doing is standing here. Okay, dear Maitre of Volterne, as you are no doubt aware, our practice is charged with undertaking negotiations for the take. One moment. Sorry about that, had a bit of coughing fit. Alright. As you are no doubt aware, our practice is charged with undertaking negotiations for the takeover of the Vorlberg Manufacturing by our client, the Universal Toy Company. It is with great sadness that we learn of the recent death of the manager and owner of the factory, Madame Vorlberg, with whom our negotiations had started. We are under no doubt that Madame Vorlberg left you instructions before her death, enabling this sale to be concluded. We should remind you of the significant boost the arrival of the American multinational would bring the economy of your region. It is for this reason that I am sure you will give our representative, Miss Kate Walker, a warm welcome. Yours faithfully, Edward Marson. Have a good day.
Thank you.
At your service.
And I think that's it.
I'm gonna go look around Valadilin. See you later.
Oh, yay, the rain stopped. Alright, peace out, and enjoy staring at that wall a bit more. Seriously, you would think. I love that thingy. Oh, look, a bird. You're the only other 3D thing here. And aren't you precious? Alright, let us go and explore the beautiful town of Valadilin. And see all of the automaton creations that lie within. Golly, the artwork really is beautiful, though. It's kind of like, I don't know, the roundness of everything kind of reminds me of like weird sort of gaudy thing, except more westernized, I suppose. Well, I guess it would be kind of western anyway, because it's like Spain, right? Barcelona. I don't know. All right, let's see what this is. It's been so
long. No need
long.
To go down there.
All right, fine. I'm just curious about things, Kate. Oh, what's that? It looks like a gateway. Pretty certain. Is this? I think it is. This looks like a factory. Fun.
That's going to work. It looks like something's missing.
It does indeed. How about we go figure out what that thing is and get on our merry way, Kate? Come on, we are off in search of a notary, right? Hey, you are a new person. What up, new person? What you got going for you? Run, Kate, don't walk. We don't got time for that.
Good morning. Are you open? Can I buy something from your bakery?
No, afraid not. Not possible. We're closed.
I can wait a while.
You can wait, but we're closed all day. Day of mourning.
Oh, for dear Anna.
Please accept my condolences.
Don't worry about it. Because of Madame Vorobolg's death, all the shops are closed. Mayor's decision. Try tomorrow.
Well, that is unfortunate.
That's a pity.
Well, what about the notary? He's technically a shop, right? He's a business. Shouldn't he be closed?
No need to go down there.
Alright, fine. We'll see what's over on this end. See if we can get our notary. Now this is quaint. Look at that. Little roses in the window. We've got a nice little tiny little cottage-like building. Can we go in there?
No need to go down there.
Really? It looks so cute though. Don't give me these options if you don't want me to go there, game. Alright, what about this? Is this the notary? Notary's around here somewhere. Notary! Hello? How goes it? Ooh, another thingy. Okay, what do you need? You need something in
your
hand.
That's going to work. It looks like something's missing.
It does, doesn't it? Uh-huh. Okay, I need something to give him. Let's see. Dialogue notebook? No, I can't talk to it. An automaton. It doesn't think. Fax 2, maybe? It might be Fax 2. Let's try it. Does this go to you? Yes? Does that interest you? Yep, this is our notary. Oh, wouldn't life be adorable if everything was like this? No security cameras, just little toys. Seriously, this would make my day-to-day life so much happier for some reason. Let us see what lies over here. There's something there for me to grab.
I should talk to the notary first.
Really? Because I just want to kind of pocket things. I mean, call it kleptomania, but it's just sitting there, ripe for the taking. Alright, let's go. Mr. Notary! Ooh, look at thee! I guess it's her curiosity with everything that makes me think. Well, this is cute. We need that for approving something. Alright, fine. Notary. Come on, move it. What was I saying?
Hello.
Something
sir.
About kleptomania.
Miss Walker, I presume. Have you had a good journey?
Everything went very smoothly.
Oh, yes, her
Thank
curiosity.
You.
I'll talk about it in a moment.
Miss Walker, please.
Wow, you just sound like an evil man. I don't remember if you're bad or not, but we'll see. You have that voice.
I
got the kind of job of the hut luck going.
I imagine you are aware of the business that brings me here.
Of course, I was waiting for you.
All right. My name is Kate.
I'm the legal representative for the Universal Toy Company. I'm responsible for.
So I understood, Miss Walker.
I am on a mission?
Miss Walker, I am afraid that the sale of the Vorarlberg factory is not as straightforward as it first seemed.
And why is that? Is it because she's dead?
Everything was agreed. We'd obtained Anna Vorarlberg's consent, and her death does absolutely nothing to invalidate that. Now, I have to be back in New York the day after tomorrow, Metro Alphotere. My client and I are impatient to seal this deal.
Metro.
I understand only too well, Miss Walker.
Well,
there
what's the problem?
An heir, Miss Walker.
Excuse me? An heir? But Madame Vorarlberg never married, as far as I know. And in my last conversation with her, she absolutely never mentioned this detail.
Well, I mean,
Miss
you can
Walker,
name people your heirs.
I was more surprised than you are. Anna Vorarlberg sent me a letter 2 days before she died. Understand, Miss Walker, that had I known about this earlier, I would have informed you. I shall read you the document in my possession.
Well? okay. I don't think he's bad.
I'm so very old. It seems that today life is slipping away from me more quickly than I imagined, and I fear that I will not be of this world to sign the takeover contract for my dear factory. So, I must make this confession to you now. My brother Hans is still alive.
La gasp!
It would not surprise me if you find this difficult to believe, but it is indeed the truth. You must remember his death, his funeral, too. Even though you were very young at the time, it was but a sordid charade dreamt up by our father. To him, the very idea that his only son should wish to leave Baladilen and abandon the family business was unbearable.
Apparently.
Once left, he preferred to think him dead and make everybody else believe this too. He obliged me to bear this terrible secret as well.
It's a bit of an extreme.
That Hans is still alive. So when I die, it is he who becomes the sole and rightful heir of our factory.
Okay, I see. If Hans Varlberg is not dead after all, then I just have to sign the contracts with him. I suppose you've already contacted him? Where can I reach him?
Not that easy, dearie.
The second half of the letter informs us that Hans Varlberg is somewhere in Syberia. I will leave the document in your hands to read at your leisure.
Now, that's something that I'm curious about. I don't know if they ever discuss it, but the title of the game is Syberia. They talk about Syberia in the game, but the title is spelled with a Y and not an I. I don't know if there's any real reason for that. And that's everything he just read to us. Right? No? There's a little extra bit, right? Sole and rightful heir to the factory. I've never had the chance to see my dear brother again. Fortunately, though, Hans and I have remained very close in thought. Throughout the years, I have been able to follow his meandering life as he sporadically sent me news. On occasions, he would write me letters, but they were rare, as my brother, since his unfortunate accident, has maintained a phobia for the written word. However, he has sent me several plans for automatons that I have eagerly had made at the factory, and I will admit that they have largely contributed to the success of the Vorlberg creations. Hans has always had a marvelous gift of breathing life into objects through clever combinations of cogwheels and springs. My little brother is a genius in the true sense of the word. Yep. Oh wait, there's more. Let us return to the matter at hand. Rest assured of my personal conviction that my brother will not object in the slightest to the sale of the factory. If I have already passed away when you come to read this letter, it is him that the matter should be addressed. I received his last letter 6 months ago, posted from the north of Syberia. I regret to say that I have received no more recent news. I am aware of the difficult situation in which my confession and the lack of further details leave you, but I wish to die with a clear conscience. I would be grateful, dear Maître Alfotter, if you could inform the American law firm with whom I have been dealing of these developments. I have grown so old, so tired. Will all my respect and final greetings, Anna Vorlberg. Is that supposed to be with? I don't know,
Anna
maybe.
Anna Varlberg had no further information to add?
Syberia. Miss Walker, I have told you as much as I know. The situation, in legal terms, is now clear. If you want to conclude this sale, you have to find Hans Vorlberg. Apparently, there is a body lying in the town cemetery. There also seems to be some ghost wandering around Syberia. It seems you have your work cut out for you. Believe me, Miss Walker, when I say that I am most sorry for this regrettable setback. Most sorry.
Great. What now, then?
Go to Syberia!
You'll find out more in the Varlberg factory archives. You will find the key in the waiting room. My role in this affair finishes here with the reading of this letter. And now, if you'll excuse me, I must rest. You see, my health is not excellent at the moment, and my doctor forbids me from working for too long. I will not detain you for any longer, Miss Walker. Do not forget to close the door as you go out.
Goodbye, sir.
So your creepy, evil voice is just a result of your health problems. I am truly sorry for being so judgmental. I just could not remember you in the slightest, dude. What do we got here? Side door? Where does that lead to?
No. Anything need interesting? To go down there.
All right. I was hoping that you'd be a bit more curious, Kate. I mean, she seems curious as is. But, I mean, she is kind of just doing her job. Alright, key. I know what the key is. This is the key. Use that key to get to the factory. Let's go. Grab that thing. Just fits down your shirt front, huh? Got, like, just pocketing a bunch of gears and papers and stuff, and yet we're still meant to believe that she has such a form-fitting, jacket? Blouse? I guess it's a jacket. Like a leather jacket, right? It was this way, right? Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Bakery man, how's it going? Bye! I feel like that's important somehow. But I don't think it is, because I can't interact with it. That little hook on the line there. It just draws the eye. Up, oh, yellow! What up?
Hello?
Kate?
Dan, I'm so pleased to hear your voice.
How are you, honey? Did you have a good trip?
Oh, yes, darling Dan.
It was long, tiring, damp especially. But I'm okay. Especially when you...
Everything going as planned?
Yeah, I was talking.
Not really. It's not exactly what I thought it would be. You know, everything's so different here.
Actually, while we're on the subject, I managed to free myself up tomorrow lunchtime. I'll come and meet you at the airport.
That's not happening, buddy.
Won't be delayed. We're expected at the Goldbergs about 8 o'clock. I hope you have the time to take a shower and change, my poor honey bun.
Dan,
oh, golly.
I don't think the Goldbergs tomorrow night is really on.
Don't worry, Kate. You'll be as perfect as ever. Anyway, you never have to wear much to look really great.
Dan.
Wow.
Dan, I'm going to have to extend my stay here. There's one or two complications. You understand?
Kate, honey, what are you talking about? It's only a measly toy factory.
Measly is not the word I'd describe.
I've got to stay a bit longer. Dan, you don't mind, do you?
But Kate, Katie, you can't do this to me. I mean, it's the Goldberg contract. There's millions of dollars on the line here.
I know, I'm sorry. You go ahead. Don't worry about me. I'll get back as soon as I can. I promise. Okay, I've got to go. I'll call you back soon. Love you, honey.
Didn't it even say goodbye on his end? Oh, darling Kate. Ain't anybody who throws a tantrum while calling you honey bun. It's kind of awkward. It's like, you can't do this to me, it's the Goldberg contract. Get over it, buddy. We got much more important things to deal with. Right? Yes? Okay, it goes all the way down. I was like, oh no, do I need something else? Whee! Good thing I already wound him up. Factory party! Oh, so pretty. So absolutely gorgeous. Alright, which way do I go here? You'll notice that it's in the shape of a cog. Alright, you look interesting. Let's see what we got here. Can I go into this? I guess so, since she's willing to walk up to it. Nope, it is locked.
Door's locked, but I've still got to get in there.
Well, there seems to be a path going around the side, so let's check that out, shall we? Trying to remember. There's a lot of stuff to do at this part. I can't quite remember until I see everything. Alright, we got a ladder that we need to get working. This might be... sudden dramatic music. We need a key, are you sure? Okay, we gotta go find us a key then. Nah, that's probably not gonna do anything. That's just a back door, right? You are just a back door, aren't you? Can we use it, Kate? Locked?
The door's locked, but I've still got to get in there.
Yeah, we have to use this to get up there, because that's open up there. Come on, Kate, let's see what we can discover back here. Follow the path. Oh, good. This seems like a terrible idea, but let's do it! Let's go get lost in a maze! Oh, hi. Wow, you're kind of a terrifying little gnome, aren't you?
Good morning. You've got a magnificent garden here.
Hi. You can say hello. Wow, you're very short.
Oh, please don't talk about it. Since my gardener automaton broke down, there are weeds everywhere. You can't imagine how much work it takes me. I don't know whether I'm coming or going. We're not used to doing without our robot help here in Vanillin. But everybody says that we're going to have to get used to it.
Well, I mean, yeah, but aren't they automatons, not robots? I thought the robot word was forbidden. Okay, fine, peace out. But you say you have a broken automaton somewhere, Gah, so gorgeous. Is there any point to being here other than to admire the gorgeousness? I suppose not. Still, very beautiful statue. Got that whole broken beauty thing going. What's it called? I don't remember. There's a word for it. Like, when something is made more beautiful by the fact that it has flaws, like a crack or something. Well, this one's open, so let's see what we can do about that. You look fascinating. How'd it go? Alright. Well, that solves that problem. Yep. To the ladder! Away! Probably going to have to come back here later, seeing as we have that gate over there, but for now, let's get this party started! Let's get this party started! She has such vast distances to cross. Vorober key. Vorober key. Use it! Goody! Oh! Okay. I thought I was going to use the gears or something. Okay, yeah, whatever, this works. Let's climb this big-ass ladder. I don't know. I don't usually have a problem with heights, but this seems like a very problematic height, and that seems super dangerous, Katie. Now this part I remember. I think. Let us explore. Let's see what we can find within. Ooh, plates! There's nothing more important than these plates. Except for that bike. Okay, there's something back here, right? I'm pretty certain of that. Ah, yes, there it is. Okay, but I can't look at it. It's too dark, isn't it? There has to be something. Up, here we go. And here is our very important... Oh! Bomo! What up, man? Did you just follow me up?
You draw mammoths for Momo?
Sure thing, Momo!
Momo, it's you! You scared me.
Ain't he an adorable little munchkin of sorts?
What are you doing in here? Momo want mammoth's picture, like Han's picture.
Sorry, I haven't got a picture of a mammoth with me.
I can
take
make one.
Take paper and pencil and draw mammoth for Momo.
Can do, Momo. Just give it.
You don't give up easily, do you?
Nope, he doesn't. Momo is very straightforward. Okay, we got the thingy. Don't worry about it.
I've got to go now. But see you later, maybe.
If, you know what, let's talk to Momo, actually. Nope, okay. I was saying talk to the Momo, but if you want to just go ahead and walk past him.
Momo, I've got something else I want to ask you.
Momo listening?
I can't remember if he'll talk to us or not.
You remember me, don't you? I'm Kate.
Draw mammoths for Momo, please.
You must find me a bit rude turning up places uninvited where nobody knows who I am. See, it's kind of my job, you know, to get involved. But don't mind me. Just carry on with what you're doing.
Momo not mind. Anna kind. Never angry.
I mean, that's you seemed right. Angry when you...
She won't be angry. Not now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she can't be angry, but I mean...
You're a sweet kid, Momo, but I can't draw. Least of all, mammoths.
Yes, you can.
Draw mammoth, easy. Hans draw mammoth. Anna draw mammoth. Kate, too.
I mean, maybe I could do a quick squiggle of a box, say, that has a mammoth inside.
No, Momo want a real mammoth.
Don't worry, Momo, we'll get you your mammoth.
My goodness, you are one stubborn boy.
Like, I was trying to figure out if he only talked about the mammoth or not, but I guess he does have other things to say, so we can
There's
go through this real
I'm
quick.
For, but I don't quite know what. I need a clue, anything that might tell me where Hans is. You want to help me, don't you?
First, you draw mammoth for Momo.
Yeah,
and
we know.
If I help you, you help me, right?
The mammoth thing is super easy, so we can take our time.
Kate is kind. Kate draw mammoth for Momo. Then Momo tell Kate secret. You've
Ooh,
got a secret?
There is a secret.
First, draw mammoth for Momo.
We understand. Alright, what about you, Momo? Or should we talk about Hans?
Do you know if Anna came here often with Hans?
Momo want mammoth's picture. Like Hans' picture.
Ah, yes. And pretty certain they spent a lot of time up here.
What's going to happen to you now that Anna is gone?
Momo big now. They want Momo live at inn. Momo don't want. Momo take care of Momo.
From what I've seen, you look pretty resourceful.
He gets by. That does concern me, though. What will become of Momo?
It must automaton. Be fascinating to live in a village full of automatons.
Automatons made by hands. Difficult work. When Momo big, he do like hands. Momo friend of automatons.
Good for you. So, that explains why he was playing with gears and stuff.
Tell
so he
me,
wants
Momo,
to be like
Did
Hans.
You come here a lot with Anna?
Mm-hmm. Anna like Momo. Anna like Hans. Anna on journey.
Journey to the afterlife.
Momo?
Sweet!
I've gotta go now. But see you later, maybe.
Alright, let's go get you that mammoth picture, buddy. Seriously, this is probably one of the simplest puzzles ever. That's why I remember it. Wait, do I have to look at it first? Probably have to look at it first. Yep. Hans, 1932. Quite some time ago. It's just that classic, not really tracing, but shading thing. See it all the time with old writing on papers and such. And there we go, we got a mammoth, just like Hans's. Very good mammoth, too. But I suppose it only makes sense, seeing as he is like a craftsman of sorts, that he'd be good at drawing, or at least sketching up things. All right, Momo, I have a gift for you. A gift of... where did it go? It's in my personal file. It is in my personal file. Here you go. Enjoy your mammoth picture. And give us that secret, you little munch. Yay! Mammoth picture. It's glorious, isn't it? So, we had a
Thank
secret?
Thank you. Momo happy. Now follow Momo. Momo show his secret to Kate.
Sweet, go for it, kiddo. Oh, okay, I thought he was running to the garden, but nope. Peace, let's go. He's over here. Is he taking us? Where could he be taking us? Momo! Momo! I don't have great memory, Momo. Where are you going, buddy? There he is. Wait, isn't that the way back to town, though? Okay. Momo! Momo? God dang it, Momo. There he is. I mean, you could just, like, walk with me rather than running ahead. I don't know why I have to run after you, buddy. Come on, girl! Move it!
We ain't got time for you and your lollygagging. We are trying to find a big old secret so we can go and find a Hans, remember? You're on a mission here, girly. You might not have the full support of everyone behind you, but- ooh, wait, what was that? That looked interesting. One second. Is that a thing? That looks like a thing! What is it? What kind of thing is it? Did not see that before. Was that there before? The Veldoline Gazette. Mourning the loss of the Queen of our Hearts, let us pay homage today to Anna Vorarlberg, who died peacefully yesterday at the age of 86. The great lady devoted her life to her business and our community. This formidable woman had an extraordinary energy, a force that allowed our automaton technology to develop and to make our valley continually proud. Her vitality was matched by her generosity and goodness, which has marked all of Valladolid's inhabitants. The mayor of our town has declared that today would be a day of collective mourning in honor of Madame Vorarlberg. Her funeral will take place this morning at 10 a.m. in the parish church, officiated by the town's own priest. Editorial, Anna Vorarlberg's death marks the end of an era in Valladolid. Madame Vorarlberg was an outstanding woman who presided over Vorarlberg manufacturing for more than 50 years. Her death seems to bring further loss in its wake, sounding the death knell of our automaton factory. The economic heart of our town, it is impossible to view her passing without concern for the future of our valley. In the last decade, computers, video games, and electronic robots have become predominant in our consumer society, rendering traditional clockwork mechanisms obsolete. The age of the wind-up toy is over. Such technology cannot compete in the modern economic climate, and has fallen by the wayside. It would have been definitively consigned to oblivion if Vorarlberg Manufacturing had not upheld its renowned savoir-faire, helping Valladolid to remain economically active. However, today the industry has lost its spiritual force, and if the future looks bleak, maybe the time has come to celebrate the prospective American takeover of the factory. But what will be the cost to the soul of Valladolid? Stiff joints, chronic hangovers, need a spring in your sup, look no further. Dr. Schwitzer's Miracle Elixir. One remedy for 1,000 woes. Is it legal to put that in a paper? I mean, I don't think it's real, but... Ecology. The protest group Mountain Peace demonstrated yesterday near the site of the new Espia Dam. They claim the construction of the dam has damaged the blue warbler's natural habitat. Intervention on the part of the forest ranger was necessary to disperse the demonstrators. Don't see how that's relevant, but whatever. Oh, wait, was that April 17th? Oh, that's brilliant, isn't it? So that was a couple of days ago. Oh, that's so smart. That's why they did it. Because the game, Syberia 3, I think, came out on either the 20th or the 21st. So they coincided with the start of the game. That's beautiful, man! would not have known that if I didn't even look at that. Right, we're after a Momo. We probably don't have any business- There's a Momo! Don't have any business with these storefronts, seeing as they're probably closed. Is this your secret? Your secret gate, Momo? All good? Yeah? Alright. Come on, Kate. They're just stairs. They won't hurt you. You can run up them. I mean, they might hurt you if you run up them. You can trip and fall and bust your teeth on the... I'm sorry, that's like a weird chronic fear of mine whenever I come to stairs. It's like, it's not a rational thing. It's just like, if ever I'm going up or downstairs, I'm like, don't faceplant. For the love of God, don't faceplant and break all your teeth. Yeah, I don't know what that's about. I don't think I've ever seen anybody do it. Like in a movie or anything either, so I don't know, it's just like a weird irrational fear. Golly, the artwork is just so damn gorgeous. Like, that's one thing about these old-fashioned games, like this and The Longest Journey. They put so much like effort into just making and drawing out these scapes. And don't get me wrong, like, you know, modern games do that too with their 3D rendering and all that, but this is like this is a different kind of art form because it's like all, you know, hand-drawn stuff, kind of. Well, not hand-drawn. Is it hand-drawn? I don't know. I mean, yeah, it is kind of hand-drawn and stuff, and then overlaid onto this. Maybe edited a little in, like, some Photoshops and stuff, but for the most part, it's stuff that they, you know, painted by hand. It's different. It's different than, you know, computer things. Oh, I can right-click to bring that up, too. Neat. Where's our Momo? I don't know, this creates a very nice atmosphere, in my opinion. It's like a very strange fantasy world. Now that might... that feels somewhat important, but I can't recall why. Maybe not, maybe I'm just familiar with passing by it. Okay, where's your secret, Momo?
There you are, Momo. This is some walk you've taken me on. I've got to say, though, it sure is mighty pretty.
Beautiful, beautiful
Momo
area.
Momo come here often. Momo like make splash in water.
Okay, so I guess our
Why
mission.
Why you brought me here? Mammoth doll in cave. Very important for hands, Anna say. Cave? What cave? Where?
Momo not liar.
Okay, help
right.
Maybe?
Now we're here? What do we do?
Kate and Momo throw stones in water.
Oh, he just wants to play.
We're here because of the cave. Something to do with the cave.
Momo and Kate, friends.
Yes, yes, we are, Momo, but... Alright.
Momo, I've gotta go now. But see you later, maybe.
I think he'll just repeat the other stuff about Anna and that. So, or maybe... Oh, golly, there's so much dialogue. One moment. Let's just see if he has anything else to say about Anna and Hans.
I've got something else I want to ask you.
Because it might change depending on the area. I can't recall. Hans?
Momo, do you really think that after all these years, Anna's brother is still alive?
Yep, new dialogue.
Anna always say Hans go away, but Hans come back, maybe.
And, Anna?
Tell me, Momo, did you come here a lot with Anna?
Mm-hmm. Anna like Momo. Anna like Hans. Anna on journey.
Yep, there's that again. Okay, so we do get some repetition.
Momo.
Alright.
I've gotta go now. But see you later, maybe.
I think the cave's up here. Or not? What do we got here? Oh! I'll see what we got. Oh, that is a toughie.
That must be broken. I've got to get a helping hand here.
Maybe. Momo? Momo, would you be willing to help here? No, come on. Down the steps. I know they're terrifying, but just walk on down them, girly. Momo, do you have anything to help me with here? Would you be willing
Momo,
to push that thing?
I've got something else I want to ask you.
Momo listening.
Yes, very good, Momo. Help me, please.
Can you help me, please?
What do?
Help
Push
me
the
open
thing.
The dam.
Momo strong.
Yay, strong Momo. Right, got this, man. One, two, three, and... You can do it! Momo strong! Oh, Momo too strong.
Oops.
It's cool, Momo. Just gonna walk away. That works. Now, what do I need this for, then? Clearly, I'm taking that somewhere. Question is where? Okay, I need to get that dam open. No, down here. Like a good girl, Kate. I think I have an idea. Wait, what's this? we walk across that? Nope, too afraid to get your pretty little boots damp. Alright, it's understandable. I think your entire outfit is made of leather or something, so it's cool. There it is! I knew this boat was important somehow. We can use this, we can... What are you doing?
I could use one of the oars from this boat as a lever. But how am I ever gonna get a hold of it?
So that's why we have this. Broken lever. I mean, you would think that the one that's been sitting in water for God knows how long would be the weaker of the woods. Just saying.
Ugh. That oar is all dirty and wet.
Really? You don't say.
Ugh. That oar is all dirty and wet.
Are you kidding me here, Kate? Is there... Are you going to have him do it, really? Yeah, I can use the cassette to pick it up. No? You are a shameful, shameful creature. Hey, Momo, would you do me a solid and, like, pick up that oar for me? Because I'm too... I cannot possibly have a dirty and wet oar in my hand.
Momo listening.
I need you to do all my dirty work for me,
dude. Move the oar nearer. Be a good boy and carry it for me.
Golly, she's so awful. Kate! It's just a wet oar. It's not going to burn off your hand. I guess we need to give Momo something to do, though, don't we? Got it? Okay? Not too wet for you? Is it because he has the gloves on his hand? Is that supposed to make him better at holding oars than us? Let's see if we can get this gate open now so we don't get our boots wet. Come on, Kate. You have an aversion to water, not to walking to the next area.
Momo, I've got something else I want to ask you.
I need you to open the gate with that oar there, dude. Help me.
Can you help me, please?
What do?
I need a hand opening the dam.
Momo say yes. Momo's strong.
Yay, Momo. You got it, dude? Yeah! Out with that old dry wood and in with the wet wood. Which apparently greases up the entire thing for some reason.
Momo very strong.
Indeed you are, my good boy. On your way. Go throw stones in waters or something. Or pick up wet sticks. I have no further need of you. I might, I don't know actually. Oh, nope, he's gone. Okay, I feel like, yeah, this is our cave. Ooh, so spooky. Ooh! They're the mammoths. Not going to look at that at all? Neat. Oh, I can't examine it? I kind of wanted to examine it. Oh well. Cool! Mammoth doll. And mammoth cave paintings. So this is where the interest in mammoths began, huh? He must have copied them from the drawings on the wall. Come on, out we go. Now, what else can we do? So we have the doll. Very important mammoth doll. Oh, we got a phone call. Guess that'll tell us what else we need.
Hello?
Kate? Is it you?
Yes.
Well, yeah, who did you think it was?
I mean, you called my phone.
I didn't recognize your voice, that's all. Must be the distance or something. So, spill the beans. What's Europe like?
It's very pretty.
Lucky lady, you. Honestly, I never get that kind of break.
Well, so far all I've seen of Europe is this tiny village, and frankly, they're not very hospitable. The whole place is getting really complicated. There's this surprise heir I've got to find.
I know. I talked to Lynn, who bumped into Joss, and she had coffee with the head honcho this morning. He didn't sound at all happy. The client's meeting him tomorrow, and when Marston tells him that the sale's not even gone through yet, whoa, you're gonna be pleased you're on the other side of the ocean when that bomb goes off.
Yeah, I get the picture. But so, how about yourself? What's up at work?
We lost the Sarah Lou trial. I worked 5 months on that dumb case.
Damn.
I remember.
So, for a bit of therapy, I went to Boomy's. The sale started yesterday.
Wow, lucky.
It was absolutely crazy, Katie. Absolute mayhem. You know that blue silk top I wanted? Guess how much I got it for.
Hopefully cheap.
$250? $200?
$140. Just get yourself back here and I'll go down with you.
Goodness.
Like it's my choice. Look, I gotta go.
Call me soon, huh?
Must be nice to just have that kind of money to throw around.
Moment of your great adventure.
Get out of here. Look after yourself.
You too.
Yeah, I will.
Like, seriously, that's just money to burn. It's like, I lost a case and, you know, that sucks. But guess what? I could go and spend a bunch of monies at Bloomingdale's. It's like, damn. What was I talking about? I was talking about something and then that woman called. Oh yeah, tricking Kate. Like, what the hell, girl? It's like, yeah, but they're not being very hospitable. I mean, you've just been running around with a very kindly little boy. Like, the notary guy's been like, yeah, there's trouble, but, you know, I'm sorry. This is just how it is. And yeah, and I mean, sure, the innkeeper was kind of not doing his job, but, like, he wasn't really an asshole to anybody except for Momo. Do-do-do-do. No, I didn't say stop. I said keep running. Keep fucking running, Kate. Come on, girly. Ah, oh, so nice. So pleasant. So pretty. Do trees grow on rocks like that? I mean, those look like rocks. It might be just, like, the hillside, but... I don't know. Is that a thing? I imagine it might be. I feel like I've seen that somewhere. But it could have just been in fantasy settings like this. Alright, what else do we have? I guess we could explore around here. I'm not sure where to go now.
No need to go down there.
Really? You sure? Absolutely certain about that.
No need to go down there.
Okay, no need to go anywhere. What about over here? Okay, that's the notary. Wait, is that a thing? Anything over here? Like, this looks like
no
could
need
be
to
interesting.
Go down there.
Okay, nope, that's right. We are worried. Let's see, where haven't we been? We've been to the notary. We've been to this guy, we've been there. That's all been checked off our list. No, that's nothing. We already checked that. She's like, no need to go down there, remember? I mean, I guess we can go back in the factory. I mean, we didn't explore the other areas, did we? We can either, I don't know if there's anything past the inn. Should probably check on that too. Can I mess with these? I think this is the factory part. Whirlberg, yeah, this is probably the factory, right? You open it? Oh, hey, you can open it. Yeah, this is the factory. Nicest place in here. Ooh, so creepy. Let's see what we could find in here. Can we do anything in here? I mean, we got the mammoth doll, but... I guess there's something over here. So I guess they don't really have the craftsman anymore as much as an assembly line of automatons. Again, this would just make day-to-day life so much cuter. Because this is like, hey, you don't have normal machines, you got little men machines working for you. So cute. No, there's something to collect there. We make something there, don't we? that's what that has to be. Alright. Stairs? We climb the stairs? Okay, we can come up here. What we got in here? Is this an office? Yes, this is an office. Okay, we got switches. We got stuff. Alright. Maybe we can find something of interest in here. Some documents, maybe? What do you got here? Oh, ho, ho, ho. That looks interesting, doesn't it? Oh, dear Hans! I know how much you dislike the written word, but I do not have the time to forge you a voice cylinder. I imagine that someone in your entourage will be kind enough to read these few lines to you. I received your latest set of plans. Your project is extraordinary. Your all-time masterpiece, perhaps. Time seems to have had no effect on your genius. Quite the contrary. I am so proud of you. My dear little brother, sometimes I find it hard to believe that a century has gone by since the last time I saw you. It only seems like yesterday that you rushed away from Belladolin. We undertook production immediately following your instructions to the letter. Locomotive was ready within a week, if only you could see it. But you will see it, that much I have promised you. It is magnificent. It seems impatient to set out on its maiden voyage. There is only Oscar left to build. I hope I will finish him soon. But as you can imagine, his mechanism is complex and takes a great deal of time and handiwork. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand you wish me to bring you that cursed prehistoric doll, the very thought of which I wonder if it is still in the cave, and if it is, what state it is in. But what does 60 years matter? After all, to an object already several thousand years old. I am going to find it, Hans, I promise you. I have a bit of a nasty flu at the moment, which is running me down a little. I should be better in a few days, though. The sale of the factory is taking shape. The lawyer from New York should be visiting, and we will be able to sign the contracts. Then I shall... dot, dot, dot! I don't know, it's a little odd that she would write the dot, dot, dot rather than just trailing off. Still heartbreaking. She was all ready to go reunite with him. And then that happens. Madame Vorlberg, Rue Grand, Belladolin, blah blah blah, July 20th, 2001. Object recovery. Was it 2001 then? Madam, you will have received several warnings from my office concerning penalty charges incurred on unpaid invoices from the company Lacombe. The total debt of which you are responsible for currently stands, at 47,782.46 francs? I strongly advise- that's not too much, actually, if you're, like, I don't know, a rich person, you know, with a whole company and everything, I mean. Unless francs is more than U.S. currency. How much is francs? I strongly advise you to acquit yourself of this debt by sending the necessary funds to our payment center. In the absence of such response on your part, I will be obliged to undertake legal proceedings against you to recover the outstanding funds, blah blah blah. Yours faithfully, sir, blah blah blah. Madam, despite numerous follow-up letters on our part, we noticed that you owe a sum of 80,000. Ooh, she owes to different people. We are asking you to resolve the situation posed in case of non-payment. We will be obliged to suspend all supplies or refer the matter to legal authorities. Blah, blah, here's somebody else. Dear Anna, I find myself under the obligation to undertake certain procedures against your company, a situation I found particularly painful given the special relationship our bank has enjoyed with your company over the years. You yourself admit that for some time, Vorlberg Manufacturing has become a financial liability, and due to shareholder and partnership pressure, I am no longer able to underwrite your debts with the bank. I am sorry to say that we are obliged to comply with economic imperatives of this era. It is for this reason that I beg you to accept the American investors' proposal. Such a takeover comes at a fortuitous moment, as it is the only way to swell your accounts and settle your debts. It will also enable Vorlberg Manufacturing to stay afloat, streamline production, and modernize production techniques. You will thus be able to keep the Vorlberg name alive. One that in its day was a guarantee of quality and savoir-faire. Please believe me, Anna, when I say that I offer this advice not just as a banker, but also as an old friend who desires nothing but good for you. I know that such a decision cannot be taken easily. You can truly hold your head up high, my dear Anna, and be proud of your achievements through the years. My deepest apologies for bringing such unpleasant news, and I remain at your entire disposal should you need me. Yours in dear friendship, Gustave Passeri.
Oh my gosh.
So the whole reason
invoices,
she sold it...
Invoices, more invoices. I never knew the factory was in such a bad way financially. These last 2 years must have been very hard for Anna Vorarlberg.
Really wore her down. Oh, hey, you're a thingy. Can I play with you, or are you just there for show? You might be there for show. Okay, we already read that. Are they there? Nope. Alright, we got everything out here. I mean, there's that over there, and can we click on any of that? Nope, just this. Okay, we got this clocky thing. You might be of some importance. Nope, there's something here. Oh ho ho! Oh ho ho! Now this is something. Plays some beautiful music, doesn't it?
Oh, this thing's jammed.
Well, I mean, we did have the... What is this? Music cylinder? Can we put it back in? Such a pretty melody. Pretty sure that's the main theme of the game, anyway. Alright, we got a music cylinder. We have those, but we can't press those just now. Alright, let's see what else we have. There was a ladder on the side of this, wasn't there? Yeah, over there. Alright, let's see what else we can discover. We can perhaps mess with the thing? What do you want to press?
Doesn't look like that works.
Oh! Maybe... Can we put that? No? Okay. I have another idea. Nope, not dialogue notebook. That's right. Personal file. Letter from Ed Notary. Nope, none of those. Okay.
If that's going to work, it looks like something's missing.
Indeed it does. I think something paper-wise goes in there. Let's see what else we can find around here. Okay, couldn't find anything else in there, so we're going to look around some other places. I feel like we have to put something else in the machine thingy, but I don't know what it is yet, and I think we might have to find that somewhere else. Okay, we got something over here. What is it? Come on, Kate. Take the stairs, damn you. Oh, it's just a... nothing, really. What is that? Kind of furnace-y thing? Feel like we might have to replace some things. Like that might go there. But who knows? Doesn't even always seem like it's in anything. Is it a plug? It has some kind of importance. Look, another ladder thingy, but I don't know how to get to that. If we can even take that. Could just be on there for show. Okay, we went to that one. Okay, here's something else. Come on, up we go. Bordelin train station. Is that what I think it is? It's a train! Wanna go on and explore it? See if we can find anything interesting in here. I hear whistling. Ooh, so pretty. Very nice and luxurious, isn't it?
These shelves look as if they're made for valuable objects.
Oh, trust me, they are.
These shelves look as if they're made for valuable objects.
I have a feeling here. Yes? Yes! Is that where you go? We'll leave you there for now, Mammoth Toy. I feel like you'll be safe here. Okay, we can't leave out of here. Alright, well, it's one thing. I'm pretty certain I remember where other things go. Let's see about... That looks like a cylinder. Nope. It does not go there. Alright, fine. Alright, let's get out of here then. We'll leave that there for now. And let's explore what else. We did hear whistling out there. So let's find out what that's all about. Yo! I hear whistling from somewhere over here. What you whistling about, man? Even got the little thing on the side. Oh, come on. I know I hear whistling. Is it not from over here? Maybe up there? This comes later. I know that much. I can't do anything about this right now. Aha! There we are. You there, good sir. What's up with all this whistling? Do you have anything important to say? You're just there to whistle, really? I cannot interact with you at all? Oh, well, screw you, good sir. I have no time for you and your merrymaking. Alright. I'm pretty certain there's nothing I can really do with this area right now. It's just very pretty to look at the moment. Cheery jackass, I thought there was something of importance with you. Let's get out of here! Come on. You know what? Good God, girl! Just climb the stairs! I don't remember having this much trouble with her and freaking stairs before. It is quite exhausting. Can I go in there?
No need to go down there.
Okay, fine. Alright, let's go to... Golly, I don't know where else to go at the moment. Give me a moment. I'll look around. Okay, I think I found something new. Potentially. We got something there. We got Anna's diary. Took forever, man. Okay, so yesterday, okay, May 14th, 1930, yesterday something terrible happened. I do not know who to turn to, who to talk to, so I have decided to write it down. You, dear diary, are now my confidant and sole guardian of my secret thoughts. Hans lies in the next room, teetering between life and death, and I am terrified. Oh, the injustice of life. First Mama, then Hans. Please, dear Lord, don't take my little brother away as well. May 15th, 1930. Hans made me promise to keep this a secret, but it's a burden, its burden is too heavy. I know I can tell you, though, dear diary. We discovered a cave in the mountains, a marvelous cavern with the ancient paintings on the walls. Only prehistoric man could have painted them because there were depictions of mammoths, which are prehistoric creatures as well. That much I know. I hate mammoths now. It's all because of them, and because of that stupid prehistoric children's toy. Why, Hans? Oh, why did you try to take it? And why did I let you climb up there? It's my fault you are in a coma now. Hans, if you die, I do not know how I could ever forgive myself. I guess that's Hans. Or is that Anna? It's one of them. I'm assuming Hans because of the short hair, but it could just be that the hair's tied back. Alright, May 16, 1930. Hans has still not regained consciousness. Father cannot sleep, and Gertrude cries all day long. Outside, the heat is suffocating, but inside the house is icy cold and dismal. I'm still of hope, though. I know my brother, and I know his strength. He will pull through. He never gives in. May 17, she's just writing back to back. I cannot think of anything else but Hans, and all my waking and sleeping dreams. I see him fall over and over. I see his head hitting the rock and his so-so-fail pace softening. I have taken refuge in the attic. It is the only place where I find any peace wrapped up in all my memories. May 18th. 5 days have passed since the incident, and Hans still has still not opened his eyes. To see him like this is unbearable. Please, God, protect him. Take my life, not his. May 19th. I feel so desperate, so alone. I want to snuggle up in Father's arms, but I dare not. He's just so impassive. Oh, Hans, don't leave me here. May 20th. It has happened. Hans has come back to life. He opened his eyes and uttered my name. My name. Do you realize this is the happiest day of my life? I want to take to the streets and sing to proclaim my joy to the world. Thank you. Oh, thank you, God. Ah, May 22nd. It would be 22nd, not 22ndeth. How wonderful, how beautiful life is. Gertrude and I cannot stop breaking into uncontrollable fits of giggles. Who's Gertrude? Hans even wolfed down his meal today. I knew he was tough, my little brother. Even Father smiled at me today when he said good morning. May 25th. I don't know whether I'm coming or going. I'm totally absorbed in Hans' recovery. I have scarcely 5 minutes to myself to return to my refuge and scribble down these words. May 29th. It is very curious whether Hans is hungry, thirsty, or if he wants something. He cannot stop saying my name. He can't hear it. He can't bear it when I leave him, even for an instant. Gertrude thinks that I should move my bed into his room to help him sleep better. I hope that Father will agree. June 2nd, 1930. Today was the first day that Hans has left the house. He went for a short walk in the garden, but Hans is still very weak. The doctor said we should be patient and shouldn't rush him. It is so hard, though. I hope so much that life can return to how it was. June 20th. Hans has been out of his coma for a month now. He still doesn't say much and has difficulty moving. He sits motionless for long periods of time, his eyes wide open, as though lost in thought. I have often had to call his name several times before he reacts. Then he will smile, and when he does, the moment is magic for me, and I couldn't possibly be happier. June 22nd. I had to talk to him. The burden was too great. I asked Hans about the accident in the cave to find out what he could remember. He could utter only one word, mammoth. He said, and his eyes glowed so strangely when he said it that it frightened me. September 15th. I go back to school today, and for the first time in my life, I am dreading it. I am afraid of leaving Hans alone. Despite Gertrude's kindness and attention, I have the impression that Hans is much less nervous when I'm there. I'm thinking Gertrude might be the maid. October 20th. While I was doing my homework yesterday evening, Hans crept on me so quietly that he made me jump. He took a pencil and a blank sheet of paper, and curiously, he started drawing. It is the first time since his accident he has done anything but daydream. Well, it's some kind of improvement, right? October 28th. Hans scribbles almost obsessively. It is all he will do all day long. I feel the noise, Father. Nobody else understands, but I can see that Hans is trying to draw mammoths. Aww. November 16th. Today is my birthday, and Gertrude has made me an apple pie. My favorite, but Father has not returned home for lunch, and Hans doesn't want to leave his room. The best present I could ever have is to see Hans back on the way to recovery. December 25th. Snow is falling. It is so beautiful. January 20th, 1931. January 10th, 1931. The doctor visited to examine Hans. He seems happy that my little brother has finally recovered his faculties. It truly is a miracle. I don't understand why he doesn't talk more, though. Why isn't he livelier, like he was before? February 9th, 1931. It is Hans' birthday. Today he is 11 years old. I have the strangest of impressions that actually he has lost 5 years rather than gained one more. That's so sad. February 24th, 1931. So this is why Momo reminds him of her. Or her of him. Yeah. The doctor has just left. I saw him whispering with Father. Their serious expressions worried me awfully. What could they be hiding from me? I'm grown up now. At the age of 15, you can understand everything. I'm too scared to ask Father what is happening. March 15th. I've been thinking, and it seems to me that Hans' attitude isn't normal. The shock of the fall and his coma must have had much more serious effects than we first imagined. Hans, my dear brother, what is happening to you? April 4th. I have discovered the truth. Hans is stunted, physically and mentally. I eavesdropped a conversation between the doctor, Father, and Gertrude. Gertrude buried her tear-filled eyes in her apron and thought, yep, definitely a maid, and Father muttered the word retard under his breath. What an ass. How could he say such a thing? April 13th. It is Easter and we're on school holidays. This means I could spend all day with Hans and protect him from Father's permanent dark moods. You could not accept the fact that Hans, his only son, will stay in the state forever. April 14th. It is truly difficult to accept it, but it is not Hans' fault. Mine, maybe, but not Hans. I don't know how to make Father understand. He seems so full of hatred for him. It is dreadful. I feel so powerless. I guess we kind of had an indication that the dad was truly an awful person, seeing as he faked a funeral for his son, but, you know, whatever. How many more pages of this do we have? We're on May 14th.
Woo!
So many pages. Oh, goodness me. Well, let's make it through it as best we can. One year has gone by, and it feels like an eternity. The situation shows no signs of improvement, neither in terms of Hans' mental health or Father's attitude towards him. May 30th, extraordinary. Father has decided to take Hans to Paris for new tests. He says that only the French capital will... in the French capital will he find truly competent doctors. We must make Hans ready for this great expedition. June 6th, no news from Father and Hans. But I remain hopeful. I am sure they will take good care of my little brother. July 15th, they have returned. Hans rushed into my arms and started crying. It took me a long time to calm him down and get him to sleep. Well, that did not go great. Father is still as as he was before he left. The French doctors have confirmed the diagnosis. Hans will remain physically and mentally impaired. I am stunned. August 28th. The summer is coming to a close. It has been less stifling than the last. The sun has put color in Hans's cheeks. When I look at him, I have difficulty imagining that he will not change. November 16th. Father still says nothing and increasingly shuts himself away in his office at the factory. Christmas. Gertrude tells me that that love and faith triumph over any science. I lack neither. God be praised. January 12th. 1932. Father took Hans to the factory this morning. Hans was so afraid that I accompanied them. Fortunately, Father said nothing. I failed to understand why he insisted on bringing him there. January 13th. Father left for the factory with Hans once again this morning. I think he wants to persuade Hans that he could be useful for something. It is his way of resisting fate. February 17th. For a month now, every morning, Hans has gone to work with Father at the factory. I'm not exactly sure what he does there, but he seems to enjoy it, so that's good. I feel my brother's behavior has changed considerably. He is much less capricious. April 14th. I could cry. Hans made me a present, a small robot mammoth with a trunk that rises and falls. When Father saw it, he nodded his head in satisfaction. Well, that's kind of good. Like, at least he's trying to reconnect with the child and, do something for him in life. May 20th. Both Gertrude and Father now have their own robot mammoths. Theirs are even more intricate and finely tuned. Little brother is not such a retard after all. Goodness me. October 15th, 1932. Hans' mammoths now walk, raise their trunks, and wag their tails. It's incredible. He is truly gifted. December 22nd. I met the head of the factory workshop, Mr. Grips, this morning. And he said that for a young lad of 12, Hans is very gifted. It's a shame he only makes elephants. Oh, that's problematic. What's up with the little flower? February 11th. Father and Hans were locked in a long discussion yesterday. Or should I say Hans was locked in one of Father's long monologues. As it is inconceivable that Hans should go to school like other children, Father wants to take him on as a worker at the factory. However, Hans will have to stop making his own little devices. Hans silenced his half-gaping mouth and staring eyes, finally sent Father off in a rage. That's unfortunate. What's up with the flower? Like, I feel like that should have some kind of importance. Oh, February 12th, 1933, my bad. What was I thinking there? I tried to broach the subject with Hans. I suggested that he should obey Father. Learning a craft at the factory is his one chance to do something constructive with his life. He is so gifted and takes so much pleasure in making automatons. He did look like he wasn't listening to me, but I know he'll think about what I said. February 20th. It's not that Hans cannot speak, it's rather that he doesn't want to speak. He uses the least possible words for communication, except with me, but he is still very economical with his words. May 15th. Incredible. Hans was not just satisfied with learning how the assembly line works. Instead, he has completely redesigned it. Father and Monsieur Grips are taking a serious look at his plans. So, hopefully, they're realizing he's a bit of a genius. July 10th. Father has wanted to talk to me about my future since I passed my exams. He wants to send me to university because he says my intelligence is astounding. My heart was beating so loud. It is true, I do love studying, but I couldn't bear to be away from Hans. So she should be, what, 18 now, right? What a ghastly summer, September 2nd. I have been permanently torn between my desire to go to university and my refusal to leave my brother. I talked about it with Hans, but he said nothing. The same evening, I found my own little mammoth broken. Aww! So heartbreaking. I don't remember this. I don't even know if I read this, actually, the first go-around. Because I would have been... Let's see, I think the last time I played this was back in 2013 when I first heard the game. Was coming out. Syberia 3, you know? And stuff. That was the last time I replayed it, so... Shit, I might have skipped over this. Hans had another fit of hysterics at dinner again. Father announced that Hans' new assembly line would soon be finished. However, they have removed the automaton parrots that shout orders as they were deemed superfluous. Hans was livid. He hurled his soup dish to the ground and stormed off to his bedroom. What will happen between the both of them when I am not here? Oh, bad things, I'm sure. That's cute. See, he's just trying to make life a little more delightful. October 17th. Despite my scruples, right? I don't know. I'm finally leaving. Hans has not talked to me for a week. Father would not understand if I told him why I wanted to stay. My heart is heavy. You have no choice here. It's understandable enough. Christmas! It is so strange to be home. I had never left home for such a long time before. Once we were alone, Hans did not stop talking. Words just leaped from his mouth. How we laughed at his excitement. He presented me with a delightful little ballerina to replace the mammoth, he told me. I was so touched that I started crying. Distance has done nothing to harm the strong bond between us. If anything, it's improved it. That's good, though. You know, he's talking more and everything. And he made her a ballerina. He realized he was in the... Okay, yeah. That's good. Okay, September 10th. It is strange to pick up this diary once more. At my first impulse, my impulse was to tear it up, but I resisted and instead succumbed to my second desire, which was to write for a while. I am alone in my attic once more. I have been home for 2 months now, and after a summer spent living with the intense joy of being reunited with my brother, Hans has returned to the factory. Father has aged so, and Gertrude's arthritis causes her terrible pain. September 13th, 1937. All in all, these last 4 years have been kind to Father and Hans. Their relationship is less tense. They still do not exchange much conversation, but they now have a thing in common. The factory! I'm even beginning to feel a bit jealous. Silly, really. September 17th. Hans hasn't changed. To help Gertrude, he has designed a totally automated kitchen, and Gertrude can't stop moaning at the wooden puppets. Oh, how I adore them. So cute. October 9th, 1937. I went to go and see Father and Hans at work. I hadn't been to the factory in ages. It is strange how much it has changed. I was very curious to see them set about their tasks. I like Father's new office very much. Hans has a small workshop on the first floor, crammed with odds and ends. Unfinished robots and designs, exactly as I imagined it, in fact. October 15th. The factory is working very well. Orders for toys keep coming in, spurred on by the run-up to Christmas. When I was at university, I said my name was Vorlberg. People would ask me if I had any relation to the Valadolene factory. Now I know the effect that Hans' genius has had on the factory's renown. November 2nd. To make myself useful, I started helping Father set his papers in order. The most extraordinary thing of all is that for the first time ever, I have the impression that the three of us form a real family. Oh, let's see. Oh, so many more pages still. Okay. December 8th. Hans never ceases to surprise me. This is so long. Between home and the factory, his behavior is so very different. In his workshop, he is serious, concentrated, a proper young man who keeps his eye on everything going on, constantly on the move and in control. One has the impression that each single toy in his is his very own infant. At home, he turns his back into a child. At home, he turns back into a child once more, and is either moody or happy-go-lucky buffoon. Christmas, the most wonderful Christmas of my whole life. Hans and I could not stop giggling like children beneath father's disapproving glare. I know that he was only pretending, really. Our hearts are so full of hope. What was so great about the Christmas? January 5th, 1938. Hans came to see me in my bedroom yesterday evening. I felt terribly awkward, terribly ill at ease. I might have guessed Hans wants to leave. Leave Valladolid. The house and the factory. He wants to go traveling. He doesn't know where to or for how long. That's just like him. I was so shocked that I told him his plans were foolish. He left my room without a word, his head bowed. He was hoping for her approval. And here's more flower thingies. I guess she just likes them, maybe. Okay, January 7th, 1938. I thought that he wanted to leave because of father. Not at all. It's because of the mammoths. He wants to go trekking mammoths. I thought he had gotten over his obsession. I know my brother only too well. I wouldn't dream of telling him his quest is useless. It isn't worth it. He will not listen to reason. January 10th. I was so selfish that the other evening I returned to talk to Hans and ask him gently if he was sure of his decision. I already know what his reply is going to be. Nothing will make him change his mind. January 19th. Despite my profound sadness and despair, I must help Hans fulfill his destiny, fulfill the destiny he has chosen, and announce the news to father. I fear the worst. January 24th. The worst was worse than my fears. Father's anger was terrifying. He shut Hans away in his workshop at the factory and has forbidden all visits except for from Gertrude, who feeds him. I don't know if you can do that, dude. Like, that's, you can't just lock people up like that. February 1st, father has decided that Hans should remain locked up for as long as it takes him to abandon his infantile decision. Gertrude tells me that Hans is very despondent, yet highly resolute. The worry is driving me mad, as it should. You don't just lock people away at workshops and force them to work for you, dude. That's pretty illegal and abusive, dude. Yay, only three more pages. As soon as Gertrude returns from the factory, I hasten to get news of my little brother. He doesn't say anything. He just fiddles with bits and pieces, she replies, every day, with a sigh. I have tried desperately to reason with father, but I know I am just wasting my breath. February 9th. Hans is 18 years old today, and he is all on his own for his birthday, and he can legally leave if he wants to now. February 20th. In secret, Gertrude delivered to me a small robot from Hans. It's a robot of us as children. It works with a small cylinder punched with tiny holes. I quivered with emotion as I turned the key. The message it gave was simple. He was telling me he loved me very much. I think that was what we saw back up at the office that we got the music box out of. February 21st, my bad. Gertrude gave me a different tiny cylinder for today's toy. Hans is truly incredible. He has found a means of communicating between us, alone in total secret. My days are spent eagerly awaiting. Yeah, praise Gertrude, dude. Going against the dad's orders and delivering this because she knows it's important to them. Yeah, that's good of her. Good Gertrude. February 27th. My days are spent eagerly awaiting Hans's messages. He has now resolved to run away. He is preparing his escape, like if it was a game. Oh, Gertrude has returned and she is beside herself. Hans has disappeared. Father has not even deigned to return to the workshop where he locked up his son, nor find out how he managed to escape. He just gave me a black look, as if he knew we were up to something behind his back. I don't know, dude. Anna doesn't seem like she, helped up too much there. He kind of did it on his own. March 7th. It is beginning to dawn on me that Hans is gone. I miss him so much. Lord, please protect my little brother and watch over him for me. March 11th. With Hans gone, father now locks himself away, night to day, at the factory. The house is so gloomy now. March 12th. This morning, I caught father in the drawing room and sawing a coffin on the trestle. The sight of it made my blood freeze. What on earth is he up to? My questions meet only with stony silence and a permanent black countenance. March 13th. Behind closed curtains, the drawing room with the coffin surrounded by huge candles has become a veritable funeral chamber. March 14th. This is ghastly. I have just understood what father is up to. This morning, the priest came to pray over before the coffin, and I finally caught on. Father is in mourning for the death of Hans. father made the priest believe that his son was dead. How could he do such a thing? March 16th. In the madness occasioned by his grief, my father grows ever more cold and calculating. He contacted his old friend, Dr. Schmoll, who duly drew up a bona fide death certificate without even seeing the body. I dare not imagine what yarn he spun. March 17th, 1938. Hans's funeral will be officially held next Sunday. Father strictly forbade me to attend. The sordid masquerade makes me feel ill, but I cannot denounce the subterfuge, or else I will display my father's mental instability to the world. The shame would kill him. That much is certain. March 23rd, not 23rd, 1938. I have to get away, far, far away. April 23rd. No, I will not leave. I have thought long and hard. My life is here, next to my father. He needs me too much now. The factory needs me, because father is incapable of running it now. Besides, I can only find peace of mind among Hans's robots. And, how shall I know when he has sent me new ones, if I am not at home to receive them? No, I shall not leave. My destiny is to remain here and keep watch. All the way until she dies. Golly, that is heartbreaking, man. Oh my gosh. My legs. Ugh, my legs. I was propped up on my legs the entire time we were reading this. Nothing to say about that, Kate? Really? Like, that's just some sad, sad stuff. Okay, that was new. Is there anything else that we can find in here? Okay, we already looked at that. There are more gears up there, but I don't think we can mess with that. Can we take those? No. Will looking at the mammoth do anything for us? Nope, it just tells us about Hans. Alright, I think this is pretty good place to stop today's episode. They're going to be really long episodes because, like I said, I'm trying to speed through this game as much as possible. But, yeah, so now we know, like, the full details of Hans's departure from everything. And it's pretty damn heartbreaking because, like, I don't know, I feel like, you know, the father did have a deep love for his children. I mean, clearly he failed to show it after the accident, but the fact that, you know, he was, you know, so hopeful for everything and that his son would recover and that it sent him into such a dark mood probably, you know, means that he cared a great deal about Hans from the start of everything. Like, he was clearly mad at the sister that the son got injured and everything. And so, you know, I feel like there was a good deal of love there, and that a lot of it was coming from a good place, but he just couldn't handle the fact that, you know, his child, which was once, you know, something he saw a lot of promise in and a lot of hope for, became different. Because Hans was still clearly very capable and very gifted, but his father failed to see it through his newly eccentric qualities, we'll say. And so that's kind of heartbreaking. Anna saw it the entire time, but, you know, it didn't really matter for her. And it looks like she was able to keep that same kind of love and care for her own father when it, you know, fell upon him as well. So, so sad. It's just a sad, sad story. Alright, so that is it for this very first episode of Syberia. Next time we are going to explore the compound a bit more and see, like, how we can, get about finding Hans. You know, begin our journey, we'll say. And, until next time, like and subscribe if you guys want to, and thank you for watching.